right, so Matt, let's set the scene a little bit here. We don't know a lot about what the final Golden Dome architecture is going to look like at this point, but we've had hints and we've had kind of signposts from leadership. As you guys look at it, what are you thinking about in terms of priorities for this program and kind of where you feel like the focus needs to at least start?
Well, there are some basic fundamentals that we're going to have to deal with setting up that kind of infrastructure and architecture, regardless of what that ultimate shape is going to be. Having space-based assets that are reliable, dependable, have the level of bandwidth communication that you need, and the level of security of encryption that you need to have. So there are some fundamental things that need to progress and need to be done at a higher scale than what we've done in the past. So things that go into the bus of the systems that go up there, things that give you reliable control, reliable movement, being able to navigate, being able to point in the right directions. So the navigation and guidance systems are going to have to be to a higher level than what we've had up there. The level of connectivity and the level of communication between systems, between different layers, whether it's LEO, MEO, GEO, and connectivity back to the ground is going to be essential at a higher bandwidth. And the implementation of edge processing, the ability to compute at the edge nodes, whether it's at the tracking layer or the transport layer, being able to shorten that kill chain, shorten the communication from where you're actually sensing and detecting to where the actions are going to be needed, whether it's a space-based interceptor or a ground-based interceptor, how do you process and detect and transfer the information? So there's some just core fundamental technologies that are going to be essential no matter what the architecture looks like, no matter what the platforms are going to look like. It's going to need enabling technology brought at the speed of innovation, at the speed of the mission, that's going to have to advance quickly.
So that's an interesting balance of new technologies and existing technologies that need to be upgraded or upscaled. Is there like a 50-50 split there? Are you thinking there's going to have to be a lot of new technologies? Or are you thinking this is more, we have these systems, we just need to make them, whether it's more hardened, higher CPU, edge computing, kind of increase their quality? How are you looking at that kind of split there?
Yeah, for our own interceptors and things that are ground-based, you know, I think that it's an expansion of what we currently have today. We need more missiles, more missile defense, more interceptors. That's clear. You know, we've got that message, and we are adding capacity to be able to enable new batteries and new magazine depth that enables us to intercept with our existing systems. That's a clear mandate that has to happen. The additional layers of technology that need to be inserted really need to go into the space layers and needs to be advanced very quickly, and the scaling needs to happen very quickly. Again, getting more satellites launched and more missions launched, it usually takes a very long time, you know, to get the exquisite systems that are no fail. We need to take that amount of time and shrink it, you know, dramatically to be able to get new systems fielded. We cannot accept, you know, the lead times and the amount that it takes to get new space systems fielded, that has to advance rapidly. However, we've seen a lot of the new capabilities that have been run short that don't have the level of capability that they were supposed to, that aren't operating the way that they need to. And that's one of those big threats, I think, for Golden Dome, is that we try to field things, you know, too quickly that are unproven, that as soon as you get them up there, they don't work. And that's even worse than taking too long, is taking too short, fielding things that don't work, and not being able to field something that's operational.
One of the things that seems to be emerging as consensus around Golden Dome is that no one company is going to own this. There's just too many pieces. Nobody can do everything. So the question becomes, how's it all going to work together, right? How's it all going to talk together? What's your sense in terms of prioritizing an open architecture system? What's your sense of how people are going to be able to actually tie these things together?
When people talk about open architecture, there's kind of two different ways to think about it. There's the software open architecture, which, you know, defines how you interface and how you interact and how the systems interplay. You know, think of it like when you plug a streaming device into a TV, you know, HDMI connection uploads the firmware and things work magically. You know, think about that in the defense world. We don't have that kind of architecture that says, hey, just plug in this IMU into the system and it works magically, right? There's a layer of integration because there are different architectures. creating a software architecture or a firmware architecture that you can plug and play into is going to take some direction of what that interface needs to look like, what that architecture needs to be for an open system to be able to plug and play on the software side. That's something that for Honeywell, we do across the board. We work with every OEM, you know, globally to take our systems and integrate them into larger platforms to be able to perform missions. When you look at our IMUs that go into the missile systems for navigation and guidance, we can operate in pretty much any interceptor or any offensive missile system, you know, with our technology and provide the best navigation guidance systems available. Having an open architecture for that is perfect for what we do. And it's something that will help enable more applications and broader applications. So from a space-based, you know, type of approach, similar type of thing. Our reaction wheels, our CMGs, our optical communications is how we want to work with different OEMs. It really gives us an advantage because we work with every OEM and we can see consistent themes, we can see new technology emerging, and we can see what the real gaps are, you know, in everybody's part of the architecture, which really helps us fill those gaps, collaborate with the primes as partners, and work with the different departments that really need to get that visibility of where is the technology going, what are the needs, and how do we plug and play different applications. If we talk about MOSA and open system architecture for hardware, it gets a little more complicated. Yeah. Boxes are different sizes, interfaces are different. I think standardizing on the interfaces is really where you want to get to, and being able to say, what is the interface and the software connection so that you can plug and play things. The hardware size and shape and everything is a little bit more complex because different planes look different, they have different shapes and sizes, right. But getting to that interface point I think is really essential. You know, as we're developing technologies that can be broadly applicable, we would really like to have that type of architecture that we can plug into and enable a whole bunch of different systems at the same time.
So is the hope here for Honeywell to become, you know, for lack of a better term, kind of lead integrator on Golden Dome? Is that kind of part of the pitch here?
No, we're not going to be the prime on any of these things. We want to be a technology provider. We provide enabling innovation technology to all of our prime customers. We really appreciate the collaboration, and I think with Golden Dome, it's really going to take a whole nother level of collaboration because new threats are emerging constantly, new concepts are emerging, new architecture is emerging. So no one prime is going to have the whole thing.
So it doesn't sound like you guys are going to be building your own space-based interceptor anytime soon?
Nope, that's not in the cards.
How are you guys looking at AI? Are you looking at AI as a application for Golden Dome, having a role in Golden Dome?
Autonomy is something that we do at Honeywell, whether it's for our aerospace activities or building automation or industrial automation. AI is the flavor that we're putting into everything. So we're taking a lot of those advancements and saying, how do we put this into these end systems? For defense applications, I mentioned earlier, having something that can do the edge computing so that you're reducing the time it takes to make decisions ultimately. So if you can get more of that edge computing out to the sensors and the sensing satellites or systems that are collecting the information, even within the interceptors, you know, how do you add some intelligence into the interceptors so they know what they're targeting and know what they're tracking? If you have space-based interceptors targeting a system that's coming at us, you want to be sure 100% that what you're targeting and what you're tracking and what you're firing against is what it is supposed to be 100%. And that's where we add a lot of that layer of our safety, you know, from our commercial aviation where it's 10 to the minus 9th, you know, XXX power. Where that safety and that assurance that it's going to work and safety and assurance that you know what you're targeting and what you're tracking is going to be essential to how do we do that. So we're going to add a lot of those, that smarts, that computing. Like I mentioned, our single board computers that operate in space environments. How do we advance the ASICs? How do we advance the technology in those so you can do a lot of more of that edge computing, shorten that kill chain, reduce the decision speed, and be able to intercept whatever's coming at us.
So Secretary of Defense Pete Hegseth recently gave a speech talking about acquisition reform, and the message from that was speed, 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 and more speed. He said at one point, an 85% solution is better than a 100% solution if the 85% solution is ready now and the 100% solution won't be ready for a while. From where you sit, I'm wondering, how do you interpret Hegseth's speech, And how do you think some of the things he talked about apply specifically to the Golden Dome effort?
Yeah, speed of innovation is foundational to what we do at Honeywell. You know, being a predominantly commercial company, you know, 60% of our business is commercially driven and oriented, we gotta be fast. Commercial business moves very quickly. The technology advancements that we make, we invest significantly to create new technology, investing in advancing where aerospace and defense really is. And so we can leverage a lot of those, that commercial DNA. You know, anything that we develop on the commercial side, we look for dual use over on the defense side. So it really advances and speeds up what we can do. It reduces the non-recurring cost of developing new technology for applications like Golden Dome, and enables us to work quickly with our customers and the prime integrators to bring new technology into their systems, get it fielded faster, and really advance it. That needs to extend into the defense industrial base. How do we cut out our own bureaucracy? How do we reduce our risk aversion, you know, that we have of where do we pin the blame when things don't go right? You know, instead of talking about blame and, you know, trying to pin it on an individual or a supplier for not doing something right, it's all about how do we collaborate? How do we work together to sit down in a room with the department, with the prime, and with the tier ones, at least, to negotiate what types of capabilities are needed, what types of requirements are needed, where can we scale back, and will those scale backs have the desired effect, you know, in terms of capabilities and in terms of time frame and cost. So if we want to move fast, you know, we have to really think about how do we work that together, and not just about, you know, assigning blame, but being more accepting of the risk that the Secretary talked about, taking those risks and making sure that we have a way to enable and take action on those risks.
All right, well, Matt, thanks for being here.
Happy to be here. Thanks.